Hello everyone. In this lecture we will discuss about the YAC, which is a tool for the parsers, or you can say that the syntax analysis component in the compilers. So let us discuss what the YAC is. The full form or the abbreviations for the deabbreviations for the YAC is yet another compiler, and it is a tool for automatically generating a parser given a grammar written in YAC specification. So a certain specification is given by the YAC compiler. There are certain sections in which you need to write to your own code, and accordingly this will generate a parser. And basically it generates the LALR parser, which is the look ahead LR parser, and will have to specify certain rules in which the rules are given by the grammar production rules. With the help of this block diagram, you can understand what is the basic functioning of the YAC compiler. A source program written with the extension .y is given to the YAC compiler, which generates a .c file. The same .c file, with the help of the C compiler, generates the output file. Some input is provided in the form of the strings to this output file, and it produces some output, which actually is the syntax tree of the for the given input string. This is the skeleton of the YAC specification. For example, there is a file named as x.y, which first is being converted to the star.c file whenever this x.y will be provided to the YAC compiler. It will generate the C file. The C file will be embedded with the C global variables, prototypes, and the comments. And along with this, the YAC file will have three different sections, known as definition, production, rules section, and the C auxiliary subroutine function. These three sections are separated with the help of the percentage and the percentage. Let us first see the part which is the global variable, prototypes, and the comments. So for writing all these things, you will have to start with percentage, then followed by the curly braces, then all the global variables, prototypes, and the comments, and after this it will be closing with percentage and the braces. After this we can write the definition section, which actually is the first part of the .y file or the YAC file. In this you will declare all the tokens that you will be using in your YAC specification. For example, if you are going to write the grammar production rules in the second section, you can see that the second section is the production rules section, wherein you will be writing all the grammar production rules. So in the grammar production rules, there will be some of the identifiers and some of the non-terminal symbols. So you will have to define all those non-terminal symbol and the identifiers there in the definition section. So definition section actually contains the declarations of all the tokens that you will be using in the .y file. So these tokens we already have identified through the lexical analyzer phase. So if you have used the lex tool before this, then you already have an idea about what are the different tokens in your program. Now the third section is the C auxiliary subroutines. That means for any other functions that you need to write for the C programming, you will have to write it here in the auxiliary subroutine section. So it contains any user code. For example, a main function to call a parser function, the yy parse. So this will be the part of this auxiliary subroutine. Now these three sections, which are basically broadly the three sections, definition, production rule, and the C auxiliary subroutines, are separated by two percentage, it means consecutive percentage. So two different sections can be segregated with the help of this two percentage. The same thing, the structure of this YAC file that we have discussed in the previous slide, definition section will be containing the declaration of the tokens and type of values used in the parser stack. What are the different types of the values being used in the parser stack? The rule section will contain the grammar rules with semantic routines. It means not only you have to write the grammar production rules, but you have to write the semantic rules also, whenever the reduction will take place, so whenever the reductions will have to be take place, what action will be performed according to the semantic rules? So those rules will also have to be written here in the rules section. The final one is the user code or the supplementary code. We have discussed in the last slide that the user code will have to be written here, the user code which is in the C format. Okay, so whenever we'll be writing the lex code, what is there, that there are three sections. Before the third section, before the first section, there are some of the things that we are writing as a global variable or the comments. So those are taken when the C file is generated, those are taken as a first part. And similarly, in the subroutine functions or the user code, we are writing some C codes or C functions. So those are the last component of the .c file that is being generated. Now the production rule section will be there in this .y file. So you will have to write those rules according, those programmer production rules according to certain specification. So this specification is that you have to write the left hand side symbol of the production rule on the left hand side. You do not have to apply the arrow. In the place of the arrow, you have to apply the colon. Okay, and then the symbol 1, symbol 2, and so on and so forth. For example, if the production rule is S produces AA, so here the left hand side part is S and the right hand side part is A and A. So this will be written as S colon A A. Okay, and now the semantic action will also have to be written. So those semantic actions will be written in under the braces, curly braces. So curly braces open, semantic rules, curly braces close. Usually the curly, inside the curly braces, we have to write the C specification. It means, for example, if we have to display any number according to the semantic rule, so you will have to write printf and that number. So the C statement is written inside these semantic rules. If you have two different productions generating from the same symbol, for example, E produces E plus T and E produces T. So the second production will be separated from the first production, or second production will be getting separated from the first production with the help of the standing line. So here you can see that the production produces symbol 1, symbol 2, which is the first production rule, and then the second production rule, production produces symbol 3 and symbol 4. So to segregate the symbol 1, symbol 2 production from this production, you will have to apply a standing line before the second production. Okay. Now this is the example. Here the statement produces expression, then expression produces expression plus expression, and then expression produces expression minus expression, and expression produces a number. Now see, the percentage above and the percentage on the bottom is just being written to segregate it or to specify it separately from the other two sections of the .y file. So here we have statement produces expression has been written as statement colon expression. Similarly, expression produces expression plus expression is written as expression colon expression plus expression. Similarly, expression produces expression minus expression, and expression produces a number. Under the curly braces, we are writing the semantic rules. So you can see that all everything written inside the curly braces is getting ended with a semicolon. So these are the C statements, and every C statement will be terminating with a semicolon. Now there are certain things written inside. For example, in the second production, it is written as $$ is equals to $1 plus $3. So we are going to explain this in the subsequent slides. Now, according to these productions, if we have the expression of kind 5 plus 4 minus 3 plus 2, so then this is the syntax tree which is used to parse this string 5 plus 4 minus 3 plus 2. So what is happening here, that the 5 is the number, first number, the second number is 4, third number is 3, and the fourth number is 2. So we are going to reduce this, we are going to reduce the symbols according to the bottom up parsing scheme here. So for the bottom up parsing scheme, first the number is converted to the expression with the help of the rule expression produces number, and then the next symbol we are taking the look ahead also, because look aheads will be giving us an idea about to which symbol to shift to the stack and which symbol to be taken out of the stack and reduce it with the left hand side of the production. So here you can see that the bottom up parsing is performed for every symbol, and finally the expression is converted to the start symbol, which is statement. So if in case we are able to reduce the entire string to the start symbol, it means the parsing is successful. Now, choosing a grammar, what grammar we should actually choose. So on the left hand side we have a grammar for the calculator operations, for example, the operations in which there are the symbols plus, minus, multiplication, division, modulus, and the unary minus operations. We can also include the parentheses. So there are two types of the rules which is written on the left hand side and the right hand, first on the left hand side and the other one on the right hand side. They are actually used for the same kind of the expression, same kind of the infix expression. But you can see that the right hand side grammar is ambiguous. Okay, we do not know what is the precedence rule with what is the associativity rule. So we cannot define those rules there on the right hand side grammar. Accordingly, for a particular string, two or more than two syntax tree can be generated. So that means the grammar is ambiguous, and there is no need of the ambiguous grammar. There is no requirement of the ambiguous grammar in the parsing. So the parsing is done with the help of the unambiguous grammar, which will be helping us to do the things properly. So on the left hand side, the grammar is unambiguous one, and we should be choosing the unambiguous grammar almost always for doing the parsing. Now we can define this precedence and associativity rule in the first section of the grammar rule. Percentage right is equals to, it means equals to has the right associativity. Percentage left minus plus, then percentage left multiplication and division, percentage right the exponent symbol. So here you can see that the associativity of these symbols have been defined. If the symbols have the same precedence, so we define them in the same line. Fine. For example, minus and plus are defined at the same line. Multiplications and the division are defined in the same line. And the highest priority operator is the exponent, so which is written on the bottom. Multiplication and division are the second highest, so it is written in this as the second last statement. And equals to operation has the least precedence, so that's why it is written at the top. Now the same one, how do we define the rules? And rules are written in the form of the grammar production rules. For example, expression produces expression plus expression. It is interesting to see here that plus is a terminal symbol, and the terminal symbol is represented with the help of a single quote. So plus is the terminal symbol, so single quotes will enclose this. Fine. Now after the end of every production you have to apply a semicolon. Okay, so you can see that term produces term multiplied with factor, then term produces factor. So here this production rule is ending for every symbol which is being produced by the term. So a semicolon will be applied in between at the last. The factor produces opening parenthesis, expression, closing parenthesis. Opening and closing parenthesis are the terminal symbols. Hence, a single quotes will be applied for these terminal symbol. So a factor produces under bracket expression, and a factor produces ID, factor produces number, and a semicolon. So here you can understand that a factor can be producing an identifier, for example A plus B minus C. So A is the identifier, B is the identifier, C is the identifier, and the expression could be like 2 plus 3 minus 4, wherein 2, 3, 4 are the numbers. Okay. Now how do we define the values? On the right hand side we are assigning the semantic rules. So for the first semantic rule, if you can see that expression produces expression plus term. On the right hand side for this particular production, expression produces expression plus term. The first part is because of this EXPR. The second term here is, or second thing here is plus symbol, and the third one is term. Okay, for expression produces term, term is the first one. For term produces term multiplied with factor, term is the first symbol. For term produces factor, factor is the first symbol. For factor produces opening parenthesis, EXPR, closing parenthesis, opening parenthesis is the first symbol. So here what is happening, we have to assign certain value as the parameter to these terms. Okay, whenever it will be reducing, the values will be obtained from the bottom of the tree, and that will be shifting towards the top of the tree. So some values are assigned to every symbol. So those values could be a number or the ID, which is getting shifted towards the top of the tree. So here in the first production rule, you can see that a $$ is equals to $1 plus $3. So this means that the $$ is equals to $1 and $3 is representing on the right. If you see that the $1 means the first term. So the value associated with the first term is stored as the value to be stored on the left hand side value, or the value left hand side term. Fine. So here the $1 is representing the first term. Similarly, in the same definition, you can see that the $2 is the second symbol in the productions. So plus is the second symbol, multiplication is the second symbol in the next production. In the opening EXPR closing, the EXPR is the second production. Second term. Now here for the expression produces expression plus term, term is the third symbol. For term produces term multiplied with factor, factor is the third symbol. For factor produces opening EXPR closing, closing is the third symbol. Okay, so $3 in these semantic rules are written according to the third term. Now once we have come to know that what is $1 and $2 and $3, we just look at what are these semantic rules signifying. So $$ is equals to $1 plus $3 for the first production rule is signifying that the value associated with the first term is added with the value associated with the third term, then whatever is the value is being given to the left hand side term. So on the runtime, these $$ is equals to $1 plus $3 will be changed with the symbols associated with these production rules. Fine. Similarly, for expression produces term, $$ is equals to $1. It means On the right hand side, the first term, whatever value the first term contains as the attribute, is assigned as the attribute to the left hand side symbol. Similarly, for the second one, term produces term multiplied with factor. The semantic rule says that $$ is equals to $1 multiplied with $3. So the value associated with the term, or you can say that attribute associated with term on the right hand side, which is the first symbol, is multiplied with the third symbol's attribute, that is factor's attribute, and then they are multiplied together and the value is given to the attribute of left hand side symbol, that is the term. Okay, for term produces factor, the semantic rule is $$ equals to $1, which is well understood. For factor is equals to opening expr closing, the value can be associated with the expr, which is the second symbol. So that is why the $$ is equals to $2. So that means the value associated with the second symbol, or the attribute associated with the second symbol, is given as an attribute to the left hand side symbol. Now for the definitions that you can write in the first section, if you have to include the header files, those header files can be given as percentage, curly braces open, the header file stdio.h, header file stdlib.h, then percentage and closing parenthesis. For defining what is the first symbol or what is the start symbol in the grammar production rules, which will be written in the second section, you define here as percentage, start and line. So line is the first symbol in the production rules. What are the tokens? To specify the tokens, we are writing percentage, token, character, comma, float, id, int and semicolon. So we have defined that these are the tokens that we'll be using in the grammar production rules. So these are the rule section. The rule section is the second section in which you have to write the grammar rules. So for writing the grammar rules, line, then the lambda is defining, or under the comment lines, we are writing the lambda, and then the grammar production rules. And for the grammar production rules, we are writing the semantic rules also. Okay, after these rules have ended, we have to apply a semicolon. So these are the rules, these are the examples of the rules. The grammar production rules: declaration, produces, type, id, list. And the semantic rule associated with this is printf, success. Okay, for writing every grammar production rule, you have to apply a semicolon. Now this production has ended, so you will have to apply a semicolon after the last thing you have written in this semantic rules. Then list produces comma, id, list or semicolon, okay, ending with a semicolon. Then type produces integer or character or float, ending with a semicolon. In the third section, where you have to write the supplementary code, you may write your own code wherein you can call many functions. For example, in the main, you are calling the yy parse, which will be calling the parse function. And similarly, there is a error code function which actually does nothing, but it actually will be checking if there is an error. So these are the two functions which is written in the supplementary code sections. So these were the three things that were written in the .y file that we have designed for writing the yak. Okay, so these are the things which are written as a part of the yak code. I again remind you that every YAC code is given an extension .py, which goes through the compiler, YAG compiler, which produces the .c file. And once the .c file has been prepared, it gets executed on the C compiler and produces the output file. In the output file, you give the input which produces the desired output. Here in the case of the parsing, we are expecting that a syntax tree will be drawn, and that syntax tree is doing the part of the parsing. So the YAG compiler is basically used for doing the parsing part of these compilers. But along with that, we are giving the semantic rules also, such that we can obtain some output based on the input given. Thank you.